Vascular access is one of the most important topics in hemodialysis because it is the way to do dialysis. Today I'm going to discuss this topic under the following sectors. I'll start with the introduction about the epidemiology of end-stage kidney disease, and then I'll mention the different vascular access, and then the one of the most important questions, timing of vascular access, and when I should speak to the patient to do this vascular access in some cases, and I'll end with guidelines. So let me just to start with the epidemiology of end-stage kidney disease. According to the last report of the United States Renal Data System that was published at the end of 2015, the prevalence of end-stage kidney disease and its treatments is increasing all through the years. If we look at the blue line, which reflects the number of dialysis, number of patients who are treated with dialysis, it's increasing all through the years. Here in 1996, it was 200,000, and then the current figures is above 400,000. This means that we are in need for the vascular access for the majority of patients with suffered from end-stage kidney disease. And here, the causes of indecision, according to the United States Renal Data System, the most common cause of end-stage kidney disease through years are diabetes, and diabetes is increasing as the cause of end-stage kidney disease, followed by hypertension, glomerulonephritis, and cystic kidney disease. And if we look at the home dialysis, the most common modality for home dialysis is peritoneal dialysis, followed by home hemodialysis. And when I brought the data on home hemodialysis, I want to just to discuss one of the important points that the effect of home hemodialysis on the vascular access. The burden of chronic kidney disease in North Africa was discussed by this meeting report of Professor and published by Professor Rashad Persoum. And as you see here, this is the number of patients, the prevalence of the number of patients per million in Egypt in comparison to Libya, Tunisia, Algeria, Morocco. And here are the causes of end-stage kidney disease or chronic kidney disease in these countries. If we look at Egypt, hypertension, interstitial nephritis, diabetes, glomerulonephritis, polycystic kidneys, and others are the leading causes of end-stage kidney disease. And here, if we look at this map, you can find the white color. The white color here is not good. It's bad because it means that there is no trustable data through these countries. So this is, we are in urgent need to have the Egyptian renal data system. And currently, the Egyptian Institute of Nephrology is working hard to establish a renal data system that includes collection of data all through the dialysis centers all over Egypt and transplant center too. And we are involved as a task force group working to collect the data from institutions about the dialysis patients. And this is my colleague, Dr. Tariq Tantawi, who is assigned to coordinate this activity through the different centers. Regarding the mortality, if you look here to the NICE renal data system, this is the orange color reflects peritoneal dialysis patients, blue color reflects the hemodialysis. Here, the number of patients, the mortality was higher in peritoneal dialysis, but currently mortality in hemodialysis exceeding the mortality in peritoneal dialysis. Again, the mortality in hemodialysis is more common than peritoneal dialysis. And this is the cost of treatment in the United States. It increased from this value in 2003, just one decade, the cost is duplicated from $15 billion to $30 billion. Again, the cost is increasing. So what about vascular access? The vascular access should be thought as a lifeline because this is the way to do dialysis. And secondly, it is the Achilles heel because a lot of complications may be associated with vascular access, especially the catheter, if we use catheter. And this is one of the most important key message of this presentation is we should avoid catheter as we can. And we should educate the patient in the pre-dialysis period to avoid the dependence on catheter for starting dialysis, because this is actually a very big problem. Here, if we look at the NICE renal data system, and this one of the major problems is the the dependence on dialysis on on the catheters. Here, the at hemodialysis initiation, as you see the green color here, reflecting on the percentages of patients who started dialysis with the catheter. But with the time, this is a prevalent dialysis, the fistula is created. Fistula. So this slide shows the percentage of the fistula in the graft here. The fistula was in this value and then increased through the years up to 60% prevalent dialysis through fistula. This slide shows the same at initiation. This color reflects the dependence on catheter, 80%, and then at 1 year, more than 60% of the patients are fistula dependent. So fistula here, more than 60%, the graft is this fraction, and the catheter is 20% at 1 year. So the initiation of dialysis through catheter reflects that the education of patients in the pre-dialysis period is not adequate. Again, what about catheter? Why we don't like catheters? Because catheters are associated with infections, hospitalization, and even excess mortality. And this one of the studies that show in this cohort study showed that in these 583 patients, that the use of catheter is associated with increasing parameters of inflammation. And as we know, inflammation is one of the cause of mortality in dialysis patients. As we know, malnutrition, inflammation, and atherosclerosis are the main causes of mortality in dialysis. This is from DOPS study. Here, this is including 50,000 patients from the United States and another 50,000 from other countries. If you look here, Japan is the best country because this is the percentage of patients on the initiation of dialysis through fistula in Japan. But here in the United States, this is the Turkey, Germany, Italy, and this is United States. 28% of the patients start with fistula and 67% through catheters. And here the Gulf area is 20% through the fistula. So this is the vascular access on instant hemodialysis. In Canada, the data shows that there is also lack of, at the time of initiation of dialysis, here even for the patient who are referred to a nephrologist, again, there is redundancy and there is decrease of the use of fistula on the initiation of the dialysis, and this needs some work to be improved. If we look at the data from Egypt, and this is the data that was collected by the Ain Shams University, and this includes data on 22,000 patients, as you see, and this is a prevalent dialysis. Catheter is used in 25% of the patients, and the most important problem is that the catheter is used is temporary catheters in the majority of cases, 94% of the cases, and this is one of the important point to be studied and changed. One of the most important questions: when should we have when should we advise the patient to have fistula or vascular access? So the timing was studied since this year, this is 2007, and this the white color reflects after 6 months and after 1 year and after 2 years from creation of the vascular access. And according to the ages, different ages, if we look here to the young age group, this is this is the benefit of doing the early vascular access, because the majority of the patient, all the patient will be dialyzed by 2 years. But here in this old age, even after 2 years, you can find for each 5 patients, only 1 patient need dialysis. So here, if we start doing the vascular access on estimated GFR 25 milli per minute, here the cost is, in this young age, old age is more than the benefit. So the timing of arteriovenous fistula creation in CKD is, it is an important decision. Should be based upon not only estimated GFR, but we should incorporate the age as well as trajectory of progression. So if we have a patient who is progressing, so we can be energetic to advise for fistula. But if the patient shows very slow progression, we should be questioned and take our time in decision of the vascular access. So timing of creation of a vessel depends upon, number one, estimated GFR, number two, the age of the patient, number three, rate of progression, the rapid the progression, the more the urgent the need for AV fistula, and the impending symptoms of uremia. So these are the four factors that we should put in mind when we decide to start to advise the patient to have a fistula. In elderly, it is very difficult. So arterial venous fistula placement in elderly, when is the optimal time? This was the question of this study that included 17,000 patients who are elderly above 67 years on incident hemodialysis, and after creation of fistula, 9,000 witnessed success of the AV fistula, and 7,000 or 8,000 have failed AV fistula. If we look at the odds of success, if the fistula is created in this period before initiation of dialysis, 6 months, the odds of success is 1. If it is below than this period, you can find the odds of success is very low. But when we do the fistula earlier, there is no more gain in the success of the odds of success. So suppose that we say we'll do fistula for all patients if we expect that dialysis will be conducted after a year or 2 years. What happened? What happened is a complication, because the earlier the conducting the fistula, the more the need for procedures. The number of procedures per patient increases by time to keep the fistula functioning. So the timing for fistula in elderly is very difficult, and we should put in mind everything and the individualization for the decision according to the patient characteristics. This is another study showing the retrospective cohort study, including 16,000 patients. All of them were elderly above 66. And here, if the index is fistula or index of the graft, and here comparing fistula versus graft, and here if the index is, if we start with fistula, the need to repeat the fistula and or graft creation is more in those patients who were starting with through fistula, and this is the same. The tunnel caster is marginally more common if we start with fistula. And repeating fistula graft or creation and or tunnel caster is more common in patients who started through fistula. So again, fistula is not the perfect for all population. The vascular access in elderly, position and statement of the vascular access working group of the Italian Society of Nephrology. All this is discussed in these articles. And we have the preemptive AV fistula, AV fistula after dialysis start, AV graft and CVC casters. What are the advantages and disadvantages of each one of these? For preemptive AV fistula, no age limit for this procedure with adequate vessel, and it witnesses lower infection rates compared to catheters and grafts, better survival, patients can shower. So all these are advantages. Disadvantages are competing risk of death before hemodialysis start, the higher rates of failure to mature compared to AV graft, more AV fistulas created than used, increased morbidity and costs. The regarding AV fistula after dialysis start, surgery is needed, most functional AV fistula will be used. Advantages of preemptive AV fistulas are maintained, but CVC is needed. So this is the advantages. Disadvantages, starting dialysis through catheters, high AV fistula dysfunction and infection rates compared to preemptive AV fistula, higher rates of failure to mature compared to AV graft, with low mean survival, actual AV fistula utilization may be short. Regarding AV graft, the advantages of starting through graft is short timing from procedure to use, days to weeks, lower infection rate compared to catheters. Here, higher cost of the grafts is the disadvantages. Need accurate maintenance with intra-interventional procedure. Regarding the catheter, it's quick and easy procedure. No needed punctures, and this is one of the real advantages of the catheter. Higher patient preference. But the disadvantages, increase the infection rates, carry higher mortality and morbidity. So we should fight against catheters as we can. This is one of the studies, included 138,000 patients, started on hemodialysis, tunnel dialysis catheters, and they discussed the issue of change to fistula or graft. Is there a difference? Here the fistula in 30,000, the graft in 10,000, and keeping the patient tunnel catheter 90,000. And the, as you see, this there was no difference between fistula and the graft. The question is, is it always the best to create a fistula? Here the answer is, according to the patient characteristics, if we are talking about male and non-diabetic, this is a fistula always superior irrespective to the age. So in age, you'll find advantages of the fistula over the graft and the catheters for male non-diabetic. For female non-diabetic, the same fistula is the best. But for diabetic, you find some attenuation here, especially in females. One of the most important points to be put in mind is the patient-centeredness, because this is the trend in medicine currently. So this is a patient-centeredness approach needs to discuss with the patients everything about the vulnerability, disfigurement, mechanization of the body, everything. We should, because for the consent to be informed, we should discuss with the patient the consequences and the complications and the actions to lessen these complications. And one of the important points is to doing controlled exercise to keep the fistula patent. And these are some of the exercises that increase the fistula maturation. Again, to summarize, how to select. So selection of vascular access depends upon many issues. One of these is the prognosis. So if the prognosis according to survival and according to the renal prognosis, according to survival, if the survival is affected by metastatic disease, by hospice care, end-stage liver disease, end-stage heart disease, so all these are associated with short life expectancy. So if we need dialysis, it's a dialysis through tunnel catheter is, I think, the choice of tunnel catheter here is more appropriate. But if there is no problem, no life-threatening condition, AV fistula is the best. If we think of the renal prognosis, if the progression is rapid, fistula or graft is needed. But if the progression is slow, we can postpone the fistula. And we can think of the graft at later date, according to the patient progression of chronic kidney disease. So this is the vascular access selection based on prognosis. If we put the age in mind, if the patient is elderly, above 75 year old, and there is multiple comorbid conditions or poor functional and nutritional status, AV graft or tunnel catheter may be the appropriate line or for management of vascular access. But if there is no comorbid conditions and good functional status and nutritional status of the patient, the favorable anatomy is present, yes, fistula is the best. If no favorable anatomy, AV graft is the best. So this is how we decide according to the age, according to the comorbidities. Based on vascular anatomy, if the artery is more than 2 millimeter, the vein is above 2.5 millimeter, and no stenosis or thrombosis by mapping, ultrasound, if all this no, so the anatomy is not favorable, AV graft is needed. If yes, and the patient low risk for failure of maturation, AV fistula for forearm. If no, upper arm AV fistula is needed. So this is how we think. The one of the important question, is it necessary to have routine radiological imaging before proceeding for AV fistula creation? According to this meta-analysis by Cochrane group, this review of the Cochrane River groups, that included 4 randomized control studies that included 450 patients, preoperative vessel imaging didn't improve fistula outcomes compared with standard of care. So if the surgeon is comfortable with the anatomy, with the veins, so there is no need for routine mapping of these patients. Some of the cases, one of the question, does creation of a fistula lead to more progression of chronic kidney disease? The answer is no. According to the evidence that we have from the study that included 123 patients for whom estimated GFR was estimated before fistula creation, the drop of estimated GFR was more than 5 millimeters per minute per year, and after creating a fistula, the drop is 0.5. This means that in this study, although it is a limited study, the AF fistula is not aggravating the chronic kidney disease, but it improves the progression, decreases the progression. So, and this is the title of the article, arteriovenous fistula creation may slow estimated glomerular filtration rate trajectory. Why the creation of a fistula has this advantage? Because in chronic kidney disease, there's hypertension and there is vasoconstriction through chemoreflex triggered by renal ischemia, and this will lead to more vasoconstriction and more ischemia and vice versa. But when we create a fistula, this will increase venous return, increasing pulmonary flow, and this lead to increasing oxygenation, and increasing oxygenation cut this bad circle, leading to improvement of the kidney, and the decrease vasoconstriction, and decrease ischemic insult, and then decrease the progression of chronic kidney disease. We should put in mind that the vascular access may have complication like inadequate blood flow, stenosis, so we should put in mind to examine the vascular access routinely, as I mentioned in the end, thrombosis, infection of cannulation sites, aneurysm, vascular hypertension, like sore thumb or sore hand syndrome, Still syndrome, ischemic hands, excessive blood flow, high output failure, recirculation, cannulation difficulty, and the limited cannulation area. But at the end of the day, the benefits exceeding the cost whenever we are approaching the dialysis. So if we have a good indication, we should proceed for fistula if the condition of the patient is, permits the fistula creation, because fistula, on-time fistula, saves lives. This is one of the complications showing hand ischemia. This angiography showing that absence of the contrast on the peripheral vessels, the radial artery here and the ulnar artery appear after compressing the fistula. Another complication is known as pincer nail, and it may be one of the venous hypertension created by a fistula. And if this is annoying the patient, the only thing is to occlude the fistula, and in this case, after occlusion of the fistula, the condition doesn't improve. If this is double lumen catheter, which is wrong here, the if you look here, the red color is connected to the blue. This means that the lines are reversed, and this increase the access to circulation. And this is the patient after the catheter. As you see here, this is the thrombus in the atria, the right atrium, and this is after surgical removal of the thrombus, a lot of sizable massive catheter related thrombosis of vena cava superior protruding into the right atrium in a hemodialysis patient. So we should be careful about the complication. This is one of the patients at Urology and Nephro Center Mansoura University at our center, and this is translumbar IVC cannulation. And this is after the end of the procedure, and this is the catheter in place in the inferior vena cava. Is there a guideline? Is there any guidelines to guide us regarding vascular access? One of the important guidelines that was published in 2015 online about the 2011 updated Japanese Society for Dialysis Therapy guidelines of vascular access construction and repair for chronic hemodialysis, and I advise everybody to read these guidelines that include advices before construction on after constructions. So here, for example, before construction, the type of surgery and timing should be determined after performing a pre-operative evaluation of overall condition and the peripheral circulation, a pre-operative evaluation through vesical examination visually, and through palpation is a requirement. In the case of the type of vascular access and location cannot be determined by visual examination or palpation of the vessels. Examination by ultrasound is preferred. Angiography is useful in the diagnosis of central vein stenosis or occlusion, but it should be performed only after considering residual renal function and the possible complication. The goals of ultrasound examination may include mapping the vein under unclear palpation, obtain deep vein information, upper extremity basilic veins, measure diameter of vessels to be used for anastomosis, determine the thickness of vessel wall, and measure arterial blood flow volume. And this is one of the initiative of Egyptian Society of Nephrology and Transplantation. We reviewed the guidelines and we selected the renal association guidelines here. And if you and put in 22 slides, including the preferred types of vascular access, preservation of society for native vascular access, timing of creation of vascular access, maintenance of vascular access, prevention, and the complication, all these are discussed, and we reviewed these UK guidelines, and we accepted all these guidelines for us. As is one of our form, how to examine, this is a physical examination regarding arm swelling and collaterals, difficult cannulations, prolonged bleed after needle withdrawal, signs of inflammations or infection, aneurysm and pseudoaneurysm, a present sign of bending rupture, sign of vascular steel phenomena, what about real pulse augmentation test, hand elevation test, all these should be periodically evaluated and put in this sheet. So long as we evaluate and screen the lab, we should also pay attention to the fistula, because we should look at fistula as the line for life, as I mentioned before. And not only a physical examination, but also we need to follow the bi-Doppler to assess thrombosis, stenosis collection, and to assess the flow. And I recommend all the candidate to look at this video on YouTube that shows clearly how to examine and how to evaluate the fistula. And this is a very nice physical examination of arteriovenous hemodialysis nephrology from this.
As we all know, arteriovenous fistula is
from Wake Forest School of Medicine. And if you go through the video, you can find the how to examine, how to inspect, how to palpate the thrill, looking at the complication,
such as cellulitis and sepsis. As you can see in this picture on the left, angry red buttonhole sites, this is staph.
And this is the aneurysm, hematoma.
Such position.
And this is the elevation, arm elevation test.
Well, the portion proximal to the obstruction or stenosis.
So this is my advice for everybody to see this video in details, because it shows here the arm elevation, showed the fistula is fine, and this is inspection for central vein stenosis. Looking at these dilated veins,
shows again the collateral veins that have appeared.
So all these
sinused hand in a person with this mobilization leads to
how to assist for pre and post
juxta-anastomotic stenosis. Of water hemor pulse is felt that not
inflow and outflow tract obstruction.
And compressible test. The augmentation test.
This is the augmentation test
to assess the adequacy of inflow pressures. The animation clip shows the radiocephalic fistula. The first part of the animation shows a normal augmentation test. The outflow vein is manually occluded few centimeters proximal to the anastomosis. The segment between the arterial anastomosis and the occlusion becomes hyperpulsatile because of the arterial pressures transmitted across the patent anastomosis. The second part of the animation shows the stenosis in the inflow segment.
So if there is inflow,
the arterial pressure is not adequately transmitted.
Yes.
And the segment between the occlusion and the anastomosis remains weakly pulsatile. Again, the panel on the left shows hyperpulsatile segment with manual occlusion of the outflow, suggestive of a widely patent inflow segment. The panel on the right shows weak or poor augmentation of the inflow with manual occlusion, outflow obstruction, or stenosis.
Regarding outflow obstruction, you'll find the difference.
Compressible, and has continuous soft thrill. With outflow stenosis, the fistula becomes pulsatile, firm, and loses the thrill. The animation video clip shows the radiocephalic fistula. The first part of the animation shows the continuous thrill that can be appreciated all along the outflow tract. The second part of the animation shows absence of thrill distal to the stenosis.
So my advice is to look at this video on the YouTube, because it is one of the important videos to be listened. This is how the if we would like to improve our surface is to enjoy our work, and this is how they use crossword for the dialysis access and beyond. At the end, thank you very much for your listening, and I'll be happy if you have any questions to send to my email. Your question. Thank you very much.